As such, viewer discretion is advised. The Austin Yogurt Shop murders occurred in December of 1991. Firefighters were called to a fire at a, I can't believe it's yogurt shop in Austin, Texas. Firefighters would find a horrific scene. Four bodies charred beyond recognition. So, today we will be breaking down this case. This case remains unsolved. Thomas was a 17-year-old senior at Lanier High School in Austin, Texas. Eliza loved reading, animals, and country dancing. As a member of the Future Farmers of America, she had dreamed of one day becoming a vet and a rancher. Eliza was also mechanically inclined and was a talented welder and small engine repairer. Eliza worked at the local I Can't Believe It's yogurt shop in Austin, Texas, along with Jennifer Harbison. Jennifer's little sister Sarah and Sarah's best friend were severely charred. Unlike the others, Amy's body was found in a separate part of the shop. Now, Amy was the youngest out of all of these girls. She was only 13 years old. But unlike the others, she was found in a separate part of the shop. She had received second and third of her body. She had a cloth around her neck and had been shot the same as the others. It was unfortunate that the swabs only provided a partial DNA profile, while authorities got a match in a public DNA database in 2017. The sample from the crime scene was not specific enough, meaning like a million people could have that same profile. Scott and Springsteen suspects. They didn't even have a partial match to the DNA that they had found. So now, one of these detectives on this case, Hector Polanco, had been accused of coercing false confessions in a previous notorious case that led to defendants also getting exonerated. So you put him on this case. Just seven jurors from the trials have stated that they would not have convicted Scott and Springsteen had the DNA evidence been available at the time. I would like to add that usually when people are like exonerated, which these men were because of lack of evidence, and prosecutors had made, but the state will like pay you basically for your troubles, like a "I'm sorry we convicted you wrongly." The state of Texas was still not convinced of their innocence despite them being let go, and paid them nothing. At the time of the killings, a known serial killer, history of multiple murders involving teenagers, but was soon ruled out. He was executed on November 17th, 1998. Austin police admit that over 50 people, including McDuff, on the day of his execution, had confessed to the yogurt shop murders. A confession Mexican authorities was soon disputed and finally ruled false. On December 23rd, 2010, Austin police officer Frank Wilson and his rookie partner Bradley Smith conducted a traffic stop on a vehicle driven by Maurice Pierce in the northern part of the city. Pursuit, Pierce struggled with Wilson before removing a knife from his belt and stabbing Wilson in the neck. Wilson, who survived his injuries, subsequently pulled out his gun and shot and killed Pierce. With the case remaining unsolved, last year, Republic Representative Michael McCall of Texas cited the yogurt shop murders as he helped push into legislation the Homicide Victims Families Rights Act, allowing for a federal review and complete reinvestigation of a case that has gone cold for at least 3 years. As part of that process, case files are updated with new technologies available was wasted on things that they were not even sure of. There were four girls, and the I Can't Believe It's Yogurt shop is literally in a plaza in Austin, Texas. That is a lot of commotion. You cannot tell me that these girls were not screaming. That's a lot of commotion. A Friday night at that, so I think it is possible that these four boys at the very least saw something, or Robert and Michael saw something and had told Maurice and Forrest about it, but I think either they were experiencing guilt because they saw what happened and didn't do anything, or they were involved in some manner. It's odd that Maurice knew that a 22 was used. He was accused of being involved. It's just interesting. But maybe, possibly, these kids knew the two men that were unaccounted for at the yogurt shop. But I do not believe a 17 years old Michael and Robert, with no prior crimes, would have been able to carry through such a vicious crime as this alone. Now, if you knew you'd be getting jail time, let alone, I'm sure, these detectives reminded them of the death penalty. I have no doubts they drilled that into their heads, because this was an evil, vicious crime. If you knew that, I don't know about you, but I wouldn't confess to murder, let alone rape, because I'm tired, hungry, scared, or angry. Like, nothing could make me confess to risking being in a Texas jail for one, if I didn't do anything wrong, let alone the death penalty for two. Like, the thought of that alone, these cops could threaten me all they wanted, I wouldn't be relenting to something at least feel guilty for. So my point is, I think some truth came out, and that the two that were convicted and confessed were involved, or just feeling guilty from not acting. But I just think we're missing a piece here. We need to know who those two men were. I feel like there had to be someone older and more experienced in crime than these boys that directed this whole thing. Possibility even that Robert and Michael were, as I said, present and had seen or been involved in the murder, and whoever did it threatened them. There has to be a missing piece here, and I think Robert and Michael may have that, but that is just my opinion. I know it sounds like I'm stating it like a fact, but this is just what I think. That is today's case. I will be adding it to my True Crime ASMR series playlist, where you can find past and future videos in this series. Thank you so much.